الله ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله سيد المرسلين وخاتم النبيين ورحمة للعالمين وصلى الله على آله الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا أوصيكم بعباد الله ونفسي بتقوى الله. Last weekend I was reciting in Majlis in the West End about poetry in Islam. And in this Majlis we had some young reciters from different communities who presented their poetry about Karbala in English. We have been encouraging this for many years now, especially in the month of Sha'ban. We dedicate the 5th of Sha'ban, the birth anniversary of Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wasalam. As a way of promoting this talent of poetry in the next generation in the language that they are familiar with. Not to say that we are, you know, totally eliminating Urdu, no, alhamdulillah. Since we started this process, notice that many of our, you know, young reciters are able to master the Urdu, Marsiya, and Noahs in a very good way. You know, internet helps that. Whether they understand all the words that they recite, I'm not sure about it. But many times I see they have translations on the screen. It means they have gone through it, which is a good sign. But of course, we had to realize that we live in a different part of the world, a different era. And so we cannot block this process of developing the English poetry talent in our religious field. I would like to, you know, take this opportunity to share the preamble for my speech that I had. I began with the Qur'an. Interestingly, chapter number 26 of the Qur'an is titled as Ash-Shu'ara, the poets. Of course, not the whole surah talks about the poets. At the end, there are a few ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the poets. And I would like to share that with you. Talking about the role of the poets in society, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins with a negative comment. You know, but you need to read the whole passage to understand the Islamic perspective. Where he says, وَالشُعَرَاء يَتْبِعُهُمُ الْغَاوُونَ أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّهُمْ فِي كُلِّ وَادٍ يَهِيمُونَ وَإِنَّهُمْ يَقُولُونَ مَا لَا يَفْعَلُونَ. He says, as for the poets, only those who go astray follow them. So it begins with a negative trait here, that the followers of the poets are all those who are astray. Do not you see that indeed they, the poets, you know, innahum fi kulli wadin yahimun, they wander about, bewildered, in every valley. You know, they go in whatever their emotions and feelings and sentiments take them. And they say things, وَيَقُولُونَ وَإِنَّهُمْ يَقُولُونَ مَا لَا يَفْعَلُونَ. And they say things in their poems which they themselves do not do. And then Allah comes to the positive side of the poets and he says, illa. After condemning the shu'ara and the poets, then he says, except. You know, illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihat wa dhakaru allaha kathiran wa intasaru min ba'di ma bulimu. Then he, you know, exempts from this condemnation. He exempts those poets who have these four you know, qualities in them. Number one, those who have iman, they believe. Number two, وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, and they do good deeds. وَذَكَرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا, and they remember Allah often, even when they are composing their, you know, poetry or reciting it. Allah is in their mind. And not only that, and the fifth one is very important, which is related to the times and the place where the poet would find himself. وَانْتَصِرُوا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا ظُلِمُوا, and such poets defend themselves and their religion after being oppressed. So those poets who become mazloom because of their personality or because of their faith, by the zalimeen, those who are oppressors, you know, they are the one who use their talent of poetry to defend themselves. So they speak out against the zalimeen. And at the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends the surah with a warning for the zalimeen, for the oppressors. And these are the words we normally recite at the end of the majlis. وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلِبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ, and those who act unjustly shall soon know their final place when the times finally change. And so, you know, every zalim has to realize that they might have upper hand, but a time will come where things will change. We have seen in our own lifetime examples of different kinds of tyrants, kings, even in the democratic country, who they have lost their prestige and image. And so, you know, they should not be thinking that because they are in power at the moment, everything is fine. No, the time will come. When the inqilab will come, munqalibun, things will change. Now, praising the poets, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions four things. Just to summarize that, iman, amal salih, good deeds, dhikr of Allah, to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and, you know, to defend themselves and their faith whenever they are oppressed. These qualities do not only apply to poets, it also applies to speakers like me. You know, this is something which we have to learn. Let me share with you an example from the early days. during the time when Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam, was in power. The Battle of Siffin. You know, Arabs had this special talent of poetry. You know, on both sides they would come up and introduce themselves and encourage their fellow, you know, people to fight against the other side. And one of those poets at the time was Najashi. Najashi, nothing to do with the king of Abyssinia. This is the Najashi who was a poet, an Arab, during the days of Amir al-Mu'mineen. A very talented and powerful poet. And he recited many, many, you know, pieces of poetry against Muawiyah, against Banu Umayyah, in support of Ali and his Shia. Ali and his followers returned back to Kufa after the, you know, unfinished business as far as Siffin is concerned. The month of Ramadan comes. Najashi had a friend, and this is very good to realize, you know, keep good company. Sometimes you might be a good person, but you go towards Jahannam because of the bad company that you keep. And it was the, you know, month of Ramadan. He was passing by, a friend of him said, you know, where are you going? He says, well, I'm going home. He says, well, why? Come, you know, I have kebab, barbecue, probably to summer, you know, and sharab. So it's not only kebab, he also, you know, intoxicants. He said, no, it's not good, you know. Islam said, come on. He pulled him And this guy got trapped. You know, so they have kebab and sharab. They spend the whole night that way. During the daytime, they come out. Both of them are drunk. It's Ramadan. Of course, when they were publicly seen to be drunk, you know, the people caught them. The host ran away. Najashi was caught. The officers of Amir al-Mu'mineen put him in prison until he sobers up. And then Ali said that, okay, you know, you have been found publicly drunk, so the punishment would be implemented, 80 lashes. It was done. Then Ali said at the end, add 20 more. Najashi was okay with 80 lashes. He turns to Ali, why this 20 extra? He says, because you violated the sanctity of the month of Ramadan. In the month of Ramadan, during the daytime, you were found drunk. So those 20 lashes was for violating the sanctity of the month of Ramadan. Najashi couldn't take that. He was okay with 80 ones, but not that 20 extras. And eventually he ran away to Syria, became a member of the court of Muawiyah, started, you know, reciting poetry in praise of Muawiyah now. Some of the companions of Ali told him that Ali, you know, he had a good talent. You know, maybe you should be lenient, forgive him, let him, you know, incite him to come back. Ali says, I don't want ashab like him. It is better, he is better with Muawiyah. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, I might have a talent, you might have a talent, but we have to be careful how we are using it. Dhakar Allah kathiran. Remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time is very important. You know, when we even look at the poets, we have to be careful which kind of poets, you know, the young people would like to follow. Some of them actually go to a level where they cross the boundaries of what is permissible and what is not. The traditional way of Marsiya and Noha, there's no problem there. But this is where sometimes, you know, the modern ones go beyond where the musical instruments and things like that are being brought in. You know, don't bring the example of what is happening in Iraq and Iran. You have to go and find out what the Sharia says. For us, an action of what is happening in Iraq or Iran by itself is not a hujjat for us. Okay, so that's one thing to keep in mind. You know, sometimes, and I gave you an example of Najashi, centuries back. I know two examples of organizations in North America, and these are the incidents of more than 25 years ago. So nobody would know whom I'm talking about or which city. One city in Canada, one city in southern part of US. Especially the one US was really shocking when I was told about it. When I visited that city, they said, Maulana, we had a poet we invited from overseas. You know, and when the local reciters are then become second class for the local organizations. All of a sudden, one day, the organizer is told that please ask your local reciter to fill in tonight. What happened? He said, well, the guest, you know, reciter who had come is not yet sober. This is the 10 days of Muharram, huh? And this is where you have to realize, I don't even question his integrity. I have a problem with the organizer. That how would they allow that person the next day to come and recite Marsiya and Noha, knowing this situation in the first 10 days of Muharram. And this is where we have to really focus on the values that the Qur'an and Ahlul Bayt have taught us, and what are the expectations that they have from us at different levels. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to be on the true path of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad, inshallah. Another example which was in Canada, only when a dispute happened within two groups, you know, issues came up, financial issues came up, and while I was just going through the numbers and the books, there was an entry for Hussein Day program where the guest, you know, expenses that they had for the guest, one of the items was wine. And it's officially been recorded there and paid from the money of the Shia organization. This is where, you know, we really, as organizations, and we have to think about these issues. It's not the talent itself. It is actually the integrity of the person is also very important. In أحسن الحديث كتاب الله العزيز بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العطوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن رحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة عما سلف من ذنوبكم. The ayat that I mentioned, these ayat at the end of Surah الشعراء, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was very clear in saying that the poets absolutely have a right, you know, to defend and protest against the zalimeen. Sometimes, you know, when we even talk about the events of Karbala, you see, this is this issue, oh, you know, I don't want to say anything bad about anyone, even Yazid. Leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, come on. You know, where is your sense of, you know, justice? What is right, what is wrong? What about this issue of siding with mazloom and opposing zalim? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually in Sūratu n-Nisā, ayat number 148, he says, لا يحب الله الجهر بالسوء من القول. Allah doesn't like when people basically, you know, speak negatively about others publicly. Except إِلَّا مَنْ ظُلِمَ, except the person who has been oppressed. The mazlum has a right to speak against the zalim. When we look at the events of Karbala, of course it is obviously zulm. It is, you know, unjust, very brutal against the Ahlul Bayt, and the azaf Sayyid al-Shuhada that we have, this is not only commemorating the tragedy, but it's also a way of expressing our protest against those who are responsible for it. So the azah has dual purpose in that way. There are some, you know, I'm just keeping the Wahhabis on the other side of the equation here. Sometimes even among the Sunni, mainstream Sunni scholars also, and I'm surprised when I see that they are also followers of the spiritual path, Sufi. They also say, you know, don't talk about Karbala. They discourage, you know, talking about Karbala. And they give in to all these ahadith about Ashura being a very blessed day. You know, this is the day where you should buy the the ration for the year, and there will be barakah in it. And this is the same day when Adam's Tawbah was accepted and Noah's Ark came to the shore. Ibrahim was rescued from the fire. All the good things happened on the day of Ashura. And, you know, even this fasting of the day of Ashura is part of this whole propaganda. Not only that, I think sometimes, you know, it's really amazing how some people become so blind. You know, you ask them why. Why you are saying I should not talk about Karbala? Let us go to Imam Ghazali. Imam Ghazali is known to be a supreme spiritual scholar and master among the Sufis. His book, Ihya al-Ulum, is very popular, even in English language. You know, you go and look at anything to do with Sufism or spirituality in Islam, Ghazali is at the top of the list. many, you know, serious scholars in the Western universities have done the translation of his work. And I was really surprised and shocked when I saw studying Ihya al-Ulum. When he talks about akhlaq, there is discussion in akhlaq about su'uvan, you know, to have negative or suspicious thoughts about someone. So he's talking about that Islam says you should not have suspicious thoughts about a fellow Muslim or a mu'min. As an example, you know what he uses? He says, for example, narrating the tragedy of Karbala is an example of su'udhan, because then you will have suspicious thoughts about Yazid. And he ends up giving the fatwa when he says, ma sahha qatluhu al-Husayn. It is not correct that Yazid killed Husayn. Wala amaruhu. Neither did he order that Husayn be killed. Wala amaruhu bihi, wala ridahu bidhalik. And he was not pleased with what happened to Husayn. You know, history is there, very clear. ومتى لم يصح ذلك عنده لم يجز أن يظن ذلك به. Since this is not true regarding him, therefore to have, you know, suspicious thoughts about Yazid, that he is responsible, is not allowed. لم يجز. It is not جائز, permissible. Now you come to the reason why he is trying to prevent the narration of Karbala. فَإِنَّ إِثَاعَةَ الظَّنْ بِالْمُسْلِمْ حَرَامٌ. To have suspicious thoughts about a Muslim is haram. قال الله تعالى, and then he recites this ayat from Surah Hujarat. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِّنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٌ. You know, the ayat which says don't entertain suspicious thoughts. And then, now we come to the motive, the real reason why he's saying don't talk about Karbala. He says, يَحْرُمْ عَلَى الْوَاعِظُ ذِكْرُ الْحُسَيْنُ وَأَصْحَابُهُ. It is haram on the narrator or the orator to mention Hussein and his companions. Why? لِأَنَّهُ يُحَيِّجُ عَلَى بُغْضِ الصُّحَابَةِ. Because it incites hatred towards the Sahaba of the early days. That is the root of the problem. Because Karbala is not the beginning. Karbala is the end result of what happened in Saqifa. You know, that's where the process started and ended up in Karbala and the killing of Hussein. So anybody who studies this tragedy and then traces the causes and the links back, this is what he's saying. Because this will create, you know, bughd, hatred towards the Sahaba. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, even when a person like Imam Ghazali talks about it this way, we have to come out forcefully to keep this tragedy, the remembrance of it alive. You know, unfortunately, attempts are even being done now. Recently in Pakistan, they just passed a bill, Tohine Sahaba. We had this Tohine Risalat. insulting the Prophet. Now you have this bill that even insulting the Sahaba is a crime, probably even punishable by death. They can take it to that extent. I saw a flyer today, they were saying, Hazrat Hinda, radiallahu anha, the mother-in-law of Rasulullah. Just to think about it, where they are, to what extent they are going. Not only don't say anything wrong about them, but to elevate them to that level that she is the mother-in-law. Come on. The anger that Rasulullah had towards her, of course she accepted Islam in the conquest of Mecca, like her husband Abu Sufyan. But it doesn't mean that, in the eyes of Rasulullah, she's okay. And this is where we have to realize that, when I look at Ibn Ghazali and his student, one of the famous fuqaha of Egypt of those days, by the name of Ibn al-Arabi. There are two individuals with that name. One is Ibn al-Arabi, who was a faqih in Egypt, and one is Ibn al-Arabi without alif lam. And that is the Arif philosopher from the from Indonesia, from Spain. So Ibn al-Arabi, this faqih, actually gives a fatwa saying, "Ma qutil al-Husayn illa bi sayfi jaddihi." Now, Zubillah is saying Hussein was killed because of the sword of his grandfather. Means according to the laws laid down by Rasulullah, لِأَنَّ بَيْعَةَ يَزِيدَ قَدْ سَبَقَتْ وَالْحُسَيْنِ نَوْضُ بِاللَّهِ بَاغَ عَلَيْهِ. Because the bay'at of Yazid had come first and Hussein rebelled against him. And this is where, sometimes you hear these similar words coming from the Wahhabi Muftis. It is the same mentality and same, school of thought. Let me end with a quotation from a very prominent and authoritative Sunni theologian, not a faqih. He was expert of Sunni theology. We're talking about Sa'aduddin al-Taftazani. He actually has an interesting fatwa. He says on this issue, اتَّفَقَ عَلَى جَوَازِ اللَّعْنَ عَلَى مَنْ قَتَلَ الْحُسَيْنِ أَوْ عَمَرَ بِهِ أَوْ أَجَازَهُ أَوْ رَضِيَ بِهِ. He says there is unanimity among us on the permissibility of doing la'an on a person who killed Hussein or ordered the killing of Hussein or allowed it or was pleased with it. وَالْحَقُّ أَنَّ رِضَى يَزِيدْ بِقَتْلِ حُسَيْنِ. And the truth is that Yazid was pleased with the killing of Hussein, وَاسْتَبْشَارِهِ بِذَلِكَ, and he was happy with it. وَإِهَانَتِهِ أَهْلَ بَيْتِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ, and his disrespect for the family of Rasulullah, مِمَّا تَوَاتَرَ مَعْنَاهِ. He says, if you look at the narrations collectively, you will see it is mutawatir. Mutawatir means narrated so many times that you can have no doubt about it. فَنَهْنُ لَا نَتَوَقَّفَ فِي شَأْنِهِ. Taftazani says, we don't have any hesitation about Yazid. بَلْ فِي كُفْرِهِ. Rather, we do not even have hesitation in the kufr of Yazid. لَعَنَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَالْعَنْصَارِهِ وَعَوَانِهِ. And so, even among the Sunni scholars, there are some who are fair-minded on these issues, that when it comes to Hussein ibn Ali, you cannot be on the opposite side. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to understand the mission of Hussein and to move it further, especially by our own practice, inshallah. اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وعلى إمام المتقين وأمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وعلى سيدة النساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام. ولا أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان. ما حيا صار البدء والطغيان هادم يا ابني الشرك والنفاق حاسد فل البغي والشقاق. صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آبائه الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام. اللهم عجل فرج وسهل مخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.